Okay, good.
I can go into presentation mode.
Zoom.
View menu.
Command Shift F.
Oh, good evening. Welcome at my office. I'm going to be here tonight to talk about React PHP. My name is Kees Kiewiet and I'm on Twitter at WarryHexamus. So, I started with React about 18 months ago for a project called VariMaps. It's a private project, so it's nothing to do with any of the companies I work for or worked in the past. To begin with React itself, it's in essence a very simple library that wraps streams into an event loop. So the streams itself become available asynchronous without blocking anything that happens. So you can handle multiple streams at the same time. So it ends up as an event-driven library that does non-blocking I/O. For example, this wraps a file you open to read and a file you open to write into the same stream and read from one into the other. And this kind of streams can be done with sockets, with files, even with timers, but that's a little bit different. The event loop is at the core of the library. And what the event loop does, it pulls the streams and make sure that if a stream has data to process, it's passed on to the right callbacks, to the right part of your application to handle it. So if, for example, you have three streams and there is one that does nothing and one that keeps getting data in, that one stream that keeps getting data in keeps being processed. And at the moment, the second stream that did nothing for a while suddenly gets data, it also starts processing the data it gets in. So one stream or one request or one file opening doesn't block another one. So you can read three or four or five files at the same time. The project VariMaps is a World of Warcraft map built in Google Maps. So you just have the basic map from the game, broken up into tiles, and available through a Google Maps-like interface. Let's start with a simple socket example. Everyone knows Munin? Munin? Munin is a server monitoring tool that keeps track of trends in your hardware. For example, you get a lot of visitors. You see that in your CPU usage, your file, your hard drive usage, or space filling up because of logs. Munin tracks that and grabs it in images like this one. So, what the library does, I implemented the Munin protocol in PHP. So to start listening on a socket, you need to know the port and the IP address. And what this does, it creates that socket to listen on. And from there, you can subscribe to events like socket on connection that triggers at the moment a new connection happens. And as you can see on line 11, you get passed a connection object that is the context for that specific connection. So you never have to deal with what connection am I working in right now, because you're always in a specific object for that specific connection. That makes working with streams, connections, and such a whole lot easier. For example, this is the protocol that Muni uses. The odd numbers are my implementation of Munin, and the even numbers are the commands sent to the server. So you start up with a friendly welcome. You ask the version and get 0.3 dev. It's current version right now. You can pass on a couple of commands. And at some point at line 8, you want to fetch the uptime of Ratchet. Ratchet is a PHP WebSocket server that pretty much serves WebSocket, just like Node.js can with Socket.io. And the goal of this is to know in what the state of Ratchet is. So we're going to fetch the data. So first off, in Ratchet itself, we again have to listen on socket. In order to have some abstraction and make it easier to manage, I'm using 0MQ, which implements some nice message queue interfaces on a socket. On a socket. 0MQ. Zero as in no. It basically is a very bare implementation for message queue. You have all the basics, but you have implement the rest. So it adds some nice features, such as callbacks on a message. Because on sockets, if you just work with really raw sockets, you get bits by bits of information. You don't get everything at the same time. So we listen here on a message. We wait for it to arrive. And then if it arrives, we unserialize it and execute it, because it's a serialized class. That command returns data, and we send it back on line 6 over the socket to the Munin instance. Now, this is the other end. This is the part in Munin node that requests data from Ratchet. It's not synchronous, because it's not needed at this point. So we open a new connection to the socket, to the 0MQ socket we opened before, and send in the command, serialized, and wait for a response. Once the response comes back, we know, well, we have something, let's process it and send it back to Munin. So Munin knows, well, the uptime is 1.78, sorry. There's a lot of things that can happen. In case a client freezes up, keeps the connection open, we want to handle that. And React offers timers. With a timer, you can use the loop, the event loop before, set, well, this is a timer, you want to wait 1, 3, 60, maybe 300 seconds before we close the connection. This is a one-off timer that just you queue it, you wait for it to go off. React also supports periodic timers. For example, every 33 seconds to let the client know, well, the WebSocket server is still here. We're still alive. You can communicate with us. I initially wrote this because Nginx would just cut off the connection because no data was going over it. After, if I recall, 60 seconds. The thing about timers is you can cancel them. So if something happens that are not needed anymore, clean them up. It saves you memory and a headache in case something goes wrong. We talked a bit about Ratchet itself. Ratchet is really simple to set up. It's a very simple example using the basic app class that comes with it these days. So we create a server, add an application to it, and start it. An application is built on these methods. It's built, in this case, built on the web application messaging protocol. It is a superset of the WebSocket protocol that allows you to do RPC calls, do pub/sub channels and such, making it easier to use for developers without having to implement all these things yourself. And for now, we'll focus on the RPC function. In this case, someone is searching on a map. There's a search box where you can type in things you want to find. What happens if you search, an RPC gets called off to Ratchet and calls the on-call command. Now, since we're doing things asynchronously, and we want to make sure that we don't block in any way in case you fire 50 or 100 searches at the same time, we're going to make a promise. Is everyone familiar with the concept of promises or futures? No. Not at all? Well, a promise is in essence a set of callbacks. Sorry? No, it's the promises are a part of React, but they're also used in jQuery and other languages. So what React does is you have three callback options. We're not using the third. The first is in case everything goes well and you can resolve the promise, the callback gets called by the results you give in at the moment. The second is in case something goes wrong. Something goes wrong, you want to bubble up the error towards the user. Tell them, well, you searched something, but Elasticsearch has gone away. And the third is a progress callback. So you can say, well, we're doing 50 things right now, and I'm at thing 30, 40. So the other side knows, well, we're this far into the process. So the promise is made. It's passed on over an event to whatever is listening on the other side. Because I'm not just doing search in that thing, I'm also doing lookups for zones, for images, for screenshots, for any nodes on the map. So the code had to be a bit more generic than, well, this I'm just going to call that function. Here comes the, I'm doing things with Elasticsearch. So everything I want to find is stored in Elasticsearch. It's also stored in MySQL. But in order to do it asynchronously, I had to use Elasticsearch. It makes things also a lot easier to find it geographically. And Elasticsearch has an HTTP API, so we're going to use the HTTP client from React. But before we can begin, we have to have a DNS resolver. The DNS in PHP itself is synchronous, so it will block the moment you try to look something up. So that had to be implemented asynchronously as well. So this set up a resolver factory, create a resolver for one of Google's DNS servers. You can use your own, and if you want to mix things up, you can create different instances of the DNS resolver for different servers. So you can, in theory, test if they give back the same response. Now, if we want to do this by ourselves and see what the IP is from amsterdampHP.nl, we just call resolve and we get the promise back. So we set, in this case, we also set the function to handle the event in case it goes right and we get an IP address back. This is useful if you want to do custom things. The HTTP client does this internally, so you don't have to worry about it, you just have to set it up. So in order to work with the client, we have to set a loop and a DNS resolver. And once again, we can mix them up to check out different results. We use this to create a request. And the request itself can be anything. And as I said before, for the specific request, you get a specific object, the context for that request. And it's 5 minutes.
Yeah.
So as you can see, I'm passing the method, the URL, and a couple of headers around for this request. This is the fun part, because we don't get it back as one chunk. At the moment the headers are written, we invoke a write to the stream that we write the search body for Elasticsearch. and then we wait until the request gets a response. We start processing that result, and at the end we resolve it. But with this code, nothing happens yet. We actually have to send it out. So we can, if we want, we can prepare a couple of hundred requests and set them out at the same time. Now, once it's sent out, once we use end, it first starts to write the body. And then the buffer comes in, the data comes in from the request. Now, as I said before, that you don't always get the whole data in one chunk. Sometimes you get small bits, sometimes you get bigger bits. And you want to buffer the data. You want to keep it there until you're done, until you can resolve the promise and send the data back to the client. Now, this is especially useful if you want to process the data when it's still coming in. For example, the Twitter streaming API works with HTTP and keeps on sending data and data. And if you want to wait for the end, you're going to wait a few hours. So in that case, once the data comes in and you reach end of a cache return or a new line, you know, well, this tweet is in, this block of JSON can be processed. So we do something with it, but we keep capturing the data. So there are some use cases for that, but not always. I want to make sure that that was in for the talk. Now, the data has been sent back to the client, but I still like to know what had happened, what did the client search for, and how fast was it. I'm storing that in Redis. Now, Redis has a asynchronous client called Predis Async. It allows you to once again hook in on the event loop and do things without blocking the rest of the process. For example, if you would do this in an AJAX request, you would have the data ready, then contact Predis, well, here's the logging data, and then return it to the client. By doing it like this, by resolving the promise over the WebSockets, once the data is back to the client, you can safely quickly insert something into Predis without actually letting the client wait for that. So we have connected and we want to insert a few things. Just push some data, increment the search count for a specific map on a specific date, and just keep those things in without actually bothering the user with it. And Redis comes with Redis comes with PubSub. Everyone knows what it is? No. PubSub is a it's like a IRC channel where everyone can connect to and everyone can send messages to. So you're listening on that specific channel and waiting for data to come in and process. And once the data's in, you can do what you want with it. Or in this case, we use a special feature in Redis that once the key named step is changed, we get notified. This is a new feature in Redis 2.8 that lets you be alerted by changes in the data set. And that was specifically useful in this case because it was in just updating a Redis key every few seconds, and I could just read it out like this without having to connect to Ratchet like before with ZeroMQ. And keep it more lean and simple, because otherwise you keep connecting. You keep connecting to Ratchet, send the data, get a response, and close connection. But just setting the data and listening on events like this, you can keep things a lot simpler in your code. But there's an important side note about it. If you see on the lower bit of code that you have to unsubscribe from it is so no one is listening. So if someone listens to a channel in Ratchet and gets notified about this data, then stops, leaves the server and isn't listening anymore. It's a waste to keep listening on the channel, keep processing data, or you can just unsubscribe and wait for the next client to connect. So this is a bit of an odd number. This is the amount of tiles that is needed for the map. Well, actually four maps in the site. So that's a whole lot of files to upload. And it normally would be easy, just zip it or tar it and upload it to the server. I'm going to host it on S3. So I can't do that, and I have to make a single request for each file. Now, with normal tools or applications that are available are usually doing that with one file at the same time, and unless you buy a premium version of it. We can do that with React. We can read a file, once again on the event loop, just open it, put it into a stream, start reading from it. At the moment you're done, it ends, just put it into the next function. And the next function picks it up, once again makes an HTTP request, and writes the data back to S3. And in this way you can upload files while reading and writing at the same time, without having to buy something extra and make it a nice challenge to find out if it works. Thanks for coming to my talk. I would really love the feedback on it, because I'm just getting started and I'd like to know where to improve and how to get better.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.